Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable life-changing audio programs.
This is Sanjay Burman reading Do Everything They Tell You Not to Do If You Want to Succeed by Sanjay Burman. Welcome. I'm glad you're here. Because if you are, then something in the title of this book likely snagged your imagination. Do everything they tell you not to do. Maybe you've been doing as you're told for too long. Your whole life, maybe. But if you're listening to this book, to me, that means you're ready to carve your own path, to be an individual, and not do what you're told. It's scary, daunting, and fun at the same time. So make sure you're ready for it. The one thing you can count on is that this book is simple to follow. I was tired of reading about motivational speakers that seemed to do everything right. I did almost everything wrong and had to learn quickly. So why not write about all the mistakes so you can avoid the same ones? I should also add that while writing some of the chapters, I realized I was not following my own advice and had to remind myself of a few techniques in this book to get past some of the challenges I was going through too. That's good. That's very good. Because it certainly worked for me. Here are a few things they told me not to do. Be a TV producer at the age of 16. I didn't listen and went on to produce Life the Program, one of the earliest shows for reality TV that would later be modeled on. I dove into TV production before I had even applied to or thought about college. I worked my way into the competitive world of Hollywood deal brokering, producing my first feature with David Cronenberg at 23 years old, with exactly no background in the field. Without any previous experience, I founded a publishing company, Burman Books, and signed the majority of the team that made The Secret such a huge success to their own individual deals. With no training as a writer, I'm now the author of 2 books. It hasn't been easy. There's no magic wand. I worked hard for all the things that I have. That's why my first book was called The Art of Persistence. This book isn't the silver bullet that will transform your life. That's up to you. You have to get up and you have to do it yourself. But what I can share with you is the way of thinking that might free your mind enough to do exactly that. And that, my friend, is the whole point, isn't it? Chapter 1. Don't be afraid, except of Shirley MacLaine. How to make fear work for you. Let's clear the deck first. Some fears are healthy, like the large animal with sharp teeth, Shirley MacLaine, and I'll get to that later in the book, I promise, or possibly your in-laws. While that might stop you from, say, climbing into the lion enclosure at the zoo, or the potentially more terrifying prospect of your spouse's family reunion, both legitimate in their own way, most of our fears do little more than stunt our potential and keep us from growing. It is without a doubt the biggest barrier to our own success. It's not procrastination. It's not fate. It's nothing more than just plain, simple fear. You know you have it. We all do. Despite the various cliffs I've jumped off of, I've got a dose of it too. I've just taken some time to see fears for what they are. 90% of them are unhealthy hurdles developed by your conscious mind to guard your unconscious from looking stupid, offending others, or breaking a value system. Fear is an emotion developed by your ego, and we know how destructive that can be. Look closely now and call it what it is. We need to get the last word in. That's your ego talking. If we sulk when we don't get something or immediately find flaws in a person that rejected us, that's our dented egos pushing back. That's where it comes from. The overriding fear we all have of looking weak or vulnerable. That's what stops us from achieving true power and freedom. Make sense? No? Don't worry. The brain is a complex landscape, one with all sorts of conforming influences. Conforming to society goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. We want to be rich, famous, and happy, and anyone who tells us they're happy without money is lying. They've just convinced themselves it can't happen to them. We're just too afraid to go for it. Why? We're told from day one that it's not something a normal person can achieve. We think only the Trumps or Blacks or one who's born with that luck. Show me a lucky millionaire, and I'll show you a billionaire who went broke 3 times before he hit it big. Why? He wasn't afraid to try. Most importantly, he wasn't afraid to fail and try again. So what's your excuse now? If you can contain your ego and balance your fear, I'll show you the next steps to your dreams. I'm constantly coaching people past their fears. I've listed a few examples below. It's funny. Each time, almost without fail, I hear the same thing at the outset. I really want to become successful, and I disagree with you. And I don't have an ego, and I'm not afraid of success. Afterwards, it's always the same response. Wow, I didn't know I had that fear or ego problem. Get out of your freaking comfort zone. If there's only one thing I would like to see happen as a motivational speaker and author, it's to see you all get out of your comfort zone. When I'm doing one-on-one consulting with people, I have them do one thing a day that scares them. We need to push ourselves to grow. We need to feel rejection to understand that it's not the end of the world, or even a second thought 30 seconds later. The Japanese have a great saying that the grass that grows long is weak and dies the first time someone steps on it. But the short grass that's always crushed by feet grows stronger. I remember going into a club with a few friends some years back. I really didn't want to go. I was never into the scene, and I don't drink, and watching me dance is like watching someone have a seizure. But I agreed to go anyway. The minute we got there, a waitress approached me and said that a girl on the other side of the bar was buying me a Diet Coke. My friends were as impressed as I was. As I began to sip the new drink, the waitress returned. I'm sorry, but the girl meant that for someone else. To add insult to injury, she even took the drink away from me. I mean, come on. I had already taken a sip, for God's sake. My friends ignored my begging to go home, and we proceeded into the club. Just as we had taken another 10 steps, security mistook me for someone else and pinned me against the wall. Okay, this was not going to be a good night. After that incident was cleared up, I was sitting at the table and I noticed a very pretty girl with her friends. She was obviously a regular, since she appeared to know everyone, but she had my eye. My friends kept trying to convince me to go and speak to her. I was way too nervous. She was with her friends and I was not comfortable with just walking up to a girl like that. Finally, close to the end of the night, I saw her pass by our table on her own. My friends pushed me from behind, so I started to try and catch up to her. As we got to a crowd of people, she was wading through them and I figured she was getting close to her friends. This was my last opportunity. So I raised my hand to tap her on the shoulder. As I did, she suddenly turned her head to talk to someone and my fingers got trapped in her hair. I pulled my hand back and with it came her head. I freaked out as I saw this potential whiplash victim. I turned to the tall guy beside me and said, "Why'd you do that?" He just looked at me with a pathetic rolling of the eyes. She looked at me with hatred in hers, and I figured, well, this was as good a time as any. "Hi, I saw you earlier tonight. How are you?" She turned and walked away. The point of the story, other than giving way too much information, is that her rejection didn't change my life. Therefore, it hasn't affected me. It was a little embarrassing, or even a little painful at the time, but by the time I got home, I had almost forgotten the whole thing. On another note, I had a bad experience after bad experience with directing, so I convinced myself I was a bad director and hired others. Finally, the day came when I had no choice but to direct The Search for the Balanced Life myself. Bruce, my lawyer, had basically forced me to do it due to time constraints and the fact that I was the only one who knew what the end product should be. The first part of it was bad, but then I kept going. It got better and better. Today, I'm no longer afraid to step into the director's chair and tell the story myself. I don't get an opportunity to do so as often since I'm producing movies, TV shows, and publishing books and speaking to audiences. But the fact that I'm not scared is what has taken a lot of weight off of my shoulders. Try it. The art of the cold call. One of the hardest things to do is approach someone blind. No introduction, no appointment, it's just ice cold. It's a feature of our personal and professional lives. A friend we want to reconnect with, or someone with power we want to hit up for a job, a sale, or a favor. But some people make their living at it. Telemarketers, a tough job if there ever was one, or real estate agents who cold call for new listing potentials. An older example is the door-to-door salesman who sold anything from encyclopedias to vacuum cleaners. Not easy, but you have to remember who you're really selling, yourself. I know, I've done it a lot of times. Anytime I had to raise money, get a team together or ask for someone's help, people would always bet on me. They can't see the future any better than I can. They don't know if it's going to be a success. But they can tell that I'm worth the bet. Now look at yourself. If you were regarded in the same way you regard yourself, would you bet on you? Most people would say no. There's a good reason. They're afraid. The cold call mentality has to be right for you to deal with it properly. You can't have a high school mentality where you're afraid you'll make a fool of yourself and be branded by the other kids. It's not personal. The people on the receiving end want you to make their lives better. They don't want to make your life worse. Think about it. Here's a tough example. A polished encyclopedia salesman rarely offers the deal to the homeowner up front. He or she will quickly ask if there are children in the house. If yes, they go for it. Not only is this a great gift, but it's a brilliant education resource for school projects, general interests, and expanding the child's knowledge. The salesman has turned what might be seen as an unnecessary expense into a valuable investment. See your cold call from your subject's point of view, not yours. How would you respond to the pitch? Would you like to buy this? It's a beautiful encyclopedia series. It's also really cheap, today only. That has nothing to do with you. Should you buy a truckload of women's bras because they're cheap? Get into the subject's head, determine what they want to get out of the deal, and let them know why their lives will be better with your product than without it. You should apply this to every aspect of your life. Your brain is wired for survival. As a result, we're always sensitized to how any situation benefits us. Some of us are a little more hardwired than others, which can lead to selfishness. Just look at some of the women I've dated. But let's not complicate things, shall we? It was a truly important cold call that gave my business some breathing room. It was with Bob Proctor. When I was in high school, the best-known motivational speaker was Anthony Robbins. He was like a rock star in the motivational world. However, for my father's generation, it was Bob Proctor. He made a huge entry into my generation with The Secret. I wasn't sure what to think of him based on the movie, but I knew that he was a very formal-looking man and brought a lot of history with him. I had put quite a bit of effort into getting him. It started with my emailing a generic email address that, of course, received no response. I was at a signing with Marie Diamond, and someone came up to us and said that he was sent from Bob Proctor's office to pay his respects to her. I quickly gave him a business card and told him that we wanted to publish Mr. Proctor. No response. Okay. I liked the whole hard-to-get game, too. There was a journalist whom I got along with, and he started to follow Mr. Proctor and wrote several articles about him. I got my in. I got together with the journalist and told him that I would give him an exclusive if he gave me the phone number for Bob Proctor. It actually worked. As nervous as he was in giving it to me, he thought of his career and also was reassured by my promise that I would never tell who gave me the number. I phoned Mr. Proctor's home every day for a week until he finally gave me the time of day. He told me he was busy and that I should call back 7 days from then. I did. Then another 7 days, and then another. It went for 3 weeks. Finally, he suggested that I meet him for breakfast. So we finally met face to face. We met a further 3 times. The only thing I knew that Mr. Proctor loved my persistence. He may have been annoyed at times, but in all sincerity, I didn't care, since he was someone who could sell a lot of books, and I wanted to make my business a success by being around successful people. It turns out that he actually liked my style and encouraged it. The more I pushed, the more he would accommodate me, even with a busy schedule. For instance, I thanked him for doing the book with us and then said, "It's too bad we don't have time to promote it with you." He looked at me and asked what I had in mind. I said I would love to do a Christmas tour with him across North America. He agreed to tour for 1 week. His team wasn't too happy with such a large commitment. But if you set your sights on something, focus and go after it. If you piss the person off, pull back a bit and then proceed again. Most people won't get upset. Those who do are feeling threatened, and therefore it's not personal. So I signed Bob Proctor to a book deal. Cause for celebration, you'd think. But I was in deep trouble. I didn't have the money to pull it off. So again, I had to be creative and think outside the box. I had just moved into a very expensive neighborhood on the waterfront, and my rent was steep. I told my father and my lawyer, Bruce, that I was going to attempt to negotiate with my landlord for a year's free rent. The funny part is, even with all the things that I've accomplished in my life, neither of them was optimistic about my chances. I took my landlord out to dinner and told him since I thought that he was a gambler, I had no idea, but I thought that this might be something he might be interested in. He would either win big or lose 12 months' rent. I offered him 2% of the profits from Proctor's book in lieu of my rent for a year. Potentially, this meant that he could not only make more than what the rent would have been, but he'd maybe be getting a check for the next 5 years. He thought about it, and an hour later, he agreed. I say this to people over and over again. The simplest solution is often the best. However, most people think that it's so simple, either someone else has done it, or they wouldn't go for it because it's too simple and stupid. Most of us use a past experience to dictate the results of a future action. Yet, when I'm one-on-one in a consultation, I will urge the person to go and do the things they know the answer to. For instance, I can't tell my parents they got mad before. I can't ask for a raise. He said no. Well, if you know the answer, then you really have nothing to lose. But if you're surprised by a different result, you're further ahead. That's just one such story in my life. My father and my lawyer have both seen it all, watching with amazement. But the Proctor situation shocked them. This was a big, big name. I knew I couldn't let him go. I wouldn't be stopped, but I had to contain my emotions. If my landlord knew how badly I needed the money for my business to flourish, he would have seen my desperation and smelled my fear and been scared off. What I showed him instead was how we could flourish. I think he's going to do very well with his gamble. Bob Proctor is a huge speaker and has been for a long time. I don't want to call it a slam dunk, but if we do our job to the best of our abilities, it should be a best-selling book. The second thing about cold calling is that you need to control your own insecurities. Don't think of yourself as being judged. People are too busy to care about the salesman they just turned down. When they hang up or close the door, it's not even a second thought. They've forgotten you. So who cares if they say no? We'll talk about what a no actually is further in. Finally, a cold call can open possibilities that you didn't see before. In a hero's journey, the hero is on a path to complete a task. However, the hero will sometimes deviate to find out more information from an aide. Your aide is your potential sale. I've been in situations where I think I know what I'm selling, but after listening to what someone really wants, I find I'm able to tailor the product to suit the market's needs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.